So you've been looking at various hair transplant clinics while doing your research, but you cannot decide which one to choose. Sounds familiar? I feel you have been there. There's so many clinics out there, especially if you're looking at the places like Istanbul, for example, there's like, what, over 400 clinics. So how do you choose? Well, after watching this video, you're gonna know exactly how to choose the best clinic for you without relying on anyone's help, especially avoiding undercover like a clinic's reps who only care about their commissions. And quickly, a few words about this video's sponsor, me. Nobody is sponsoring me. I'm my own sponsor. So I'll ask you only one thing. Hit that like button for the YouTube algorithm. It really means a lot to me. And while you're out there, make sure to subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. So when you're looking at the clinics or surgeons, individual surgeons, the very first thing you need to focus on is what else besides the hair transplants they're doing. If a clinic is doing alongside other cosmetic surgeries, like, you know, like teeth or nose or whatever, chances are they're gonna be really bad at hair transplant. And also most likely they will be outsourcing their technicians to perform the surgery itself. What you want to find is actually someone who is actually specializing on hair transplant. The second thing, once you found some clinics that actually specializing in transplants, meaning that's the only thing they're doing in their practice, just go ahead and look at their websites for some, you know, before and after pictures or videos. And look specifically whatever the clinic or surgeon is presenting themselves, because chances are they're presenting one of the best cases they like had, you know, in their practice. And what they're looking for is hairline designs that are like appropriate, that looks good, looks normal, nothing stupid like, you know, implanted hairs in the forehead muscles that when you move it, you can see the hairline moving. How the hairline has been reconstructed, which means a natural look created via like a single hair graft implanted in the frontal row of the hairline, as well as the temple peaks, etc. If multigrafts that contain between like 2 and 5 and even possibly more hairs per each individual follicular unit would be implanted in your, you know, frontal line of the hairline or temple peaks, you're gonna be looking extremely unnatural and really, really pluggy. Everyone would be able to spot a transplant from literally a mile away. And by the way, pro tip, be aware of videos or pictures taken when the hair is wet. Because when the hair is wet, this plugginess is easy to conceal. You're not gonna be able to see it properly. And when the hair is dry, that's exactly when you see everything. And pro tip number two, which is common sense, look at high quality pictures and videos. Don't rely on videos or pictures that are taken just like this. Do you see my hairline? Oh, it looks really nice. Yes, it's nice. But you cannot see the hairline, so you cannot judge the job. Another thing you need to focus on is the donor area. How it's been managed. Is it FET or FE? If it's FET, you need to focus on the strip. How it's been done, how the strip scar looks like. In which area it's been taken, because the FET scar should be exactly in the middle of the donor area, because that's where is the best quality hair. And if you're talking about FE, it all depends how the extraction's been done, and specifically how big the spaces are in between each individual, like, you know, extractions, because there should be enough hair in between extractions left. So, you know, when the hair is growing back, you're gonna be able to cover the scar nicely and you're not gonna be able to see any, you know, problem. And if you want to find out more about, you know, what to look for in a good hair transplant, so, you know, you can spot it like that, I'm gonna refer you to one of my previous video over here that I did a while ago, but the examples are pretty good. So after looking at some results of these clinics and you actually like them, the first step would be to actually find out how many surgeries per day this place is doing. For me personally, this is one of the key factors, because the more surgeries per day they're doing, the less consistency it will be. It's basically like a number game. If the clinic has like, I don't know, for example, 5 different technician teams, it's possible that one of these teams is gonna be really, really good and they're gonna create amazing results that we all see online. But what are the chances that other 4 technician teams can be just as good? Well, we really don't know. And looking at the results, especially on their website, you really don't know who exactly did, you know, these surgeries, these transplants. So it's really difficult to assess your individual success of the surgery, because you don't know which team is going to be working on you, which team created this and that result that you saw online and you've been really impressed. And also keep in mind, such places that appear online pretty good, but they're actually doing a lot of, you know, surgeries, like, you know, 5, 10, even more surgeries per day.
Per day.
They have a couple of like 8 teams that are really, really good at their job and they're performing specific hair transplant, like a celebrity transplant. So you always have to have it in the back of your head basically when you're doing your research. So general consensus, the less surgeries per day, the better. Ideal circumstances is the same person extracting and the same person implanting. It can be two different people, but this exact same person is extracting the grafts for all the patients they have, and exact same person is implanting all the grafts in all their patients. So which means if you see a result A, B, C, D, E online and you like them, you like the donor management, you like the implantation, hairline, everything, chances are you're gonna be getting something really similar. And one important aspect, a lot of people are over-exaggerating that only doctor should be doing, like, you know, the surgery. Not necessarily, there's so many great technicians. What is important, like I said, is consistency. It doesn't matter. Some technicians can be so much better than some doctors, and I've seen plenty of such examples. So don't bother too much whether it's a doctor or a technician. Try to find out consistency. And you're probably now thinking, okay, where I can actually find all of this, like, a little information. And the easiest way is actually reaching out to the clinic that you're researching on directly. Just ask them. Always keep in mind that you are the boss, you're in charge, and every single clinic wants you in their chair. So they're gonna do whatever it takes to bring you on board, basically. So choose wisely. By the way, if you're getting already some value from this video, make sure to like it, gonna help me a lot. And also subscribe if you haven't already. So the step number four would be not to actually focus on the tool that's been used during the surgery. There are, of course, a couple of important aspects. On one side, it could be handheld tools like, manual punch, motorized punch, the other types of punches with the suction, etc. And on another side, it could be like a robotic, something like Artos, for example. And in this case, the only thing you need to focus on that people that are using Artos, they're usually really not that great at surgery. And they're usually even outsourcing the technicians. But again, if you've been doing everything from first step to second to third, you probably already find out that they are not the best, you know, place. But just something to keep in mind. And also, don't bother too much about, you know, FE, DHI, you know, implanter pens, premate incisions, DHT method. It doesn't really matter. The tool is not important. What's important, it's the hand that wields it. Most of this Sapphire FE, Ice FE, or whatnot, DHI, it's all marketing. You can achieve amazing, great, dense looking result with any technique. And if you want to learn more about it, I've got a video just like this over here. Step number five would be looking at the cases just like yours. What do I mean by that? Some surgeons or clinics, they're really, really good at, let's say, Afro-American type of hair, which is extremely, extremely curly. It requires specific extraction, like a method to do it, and bigger punches, etc. But other clinics that didn't have much practice with the Afro-American hair characteristics, they might be really, really bad. They might not even know how to properly extract it. You need to preserve your donor as much as possible. And the same thing goes for someone like myself with a Caucasian, super thin, fine, straight hair. So I need to look for someone who has plenty of experience, which means a lot of cases that you can find or they can provide to you of similar results with similar Norwood pattern, which was Norwood 5 in my case. And yeah, I got two transplants. Looks great so far. I'm, by the way, a bit less than 5 months in. Hit that like if you think it looks great. And last but not least, one of the best ways to find the best surgeon for your case is by subscribing to this channel so you can learn more about the subject. And have a look at this video if you want to learn more about what to exactly look for in a good hair transplant.